came, the bath room came, the kitchen, so on. Poor people, they get together and they get off that, so on, and amongst them there are people who are who do these trades, so they can do it much cheaper. We asked this for this project. Actually, this is also another aspect of being a social entrepreneur. The when I came up with this scheme, the it was a bitter fight. It's the same thing in any project, even the stock exchange was a bitter fight. So I got eventually the worst plans available. Great places, the slums were well known for being the center of the drug trafficking, gun running, and gangs and so on. The after we built, I took my mother and my aunts and all sorts of people from the establishment there, and they were surprised that the bathroom was very clean. My mother told my aunt that they were better than hers. And people are very proud of their new apartments. So the green picture is the thing people will recognize. My friend asked Castro's design. If you do an entire neighborhood, you can, by planning, change it and have high density. Now, I usually end my lecture there and ask people for questions, but I think I should go on a little bit more, because through the stock exchange did I find the answer or the mystery of this, what is the big riddle in the whole world. I would like to suggest that there are sort of two spheres. One sphere is where you have to find the correct solution commercially, and that is the money sphere. But that is not the driver. The driver is the social or the social entrepreneur sphere. This is what I think it is. And I give it a term, it may get realized or it may not, as an internet of emotions and social acts. Because the scene is that these are the people of the community in an urban area. They have a whole lot of needs. What must be provided for them is sort of a mapping of these needs into themselves in a continuous way. So there are basics. The basics in the social sphere is empathy. Empathy now is no longer just a social term. It is a term used in by the neuroscientists, and it is supposed to be that I think you have had some sessions on empathy. To my mind, the best explanations are given by RSA on the YouTube, the RSA Royal Society of Arts. Empathy is those crying babies, that is, when one baby crying, the other baby is also crying. And empathy is when somebody has a feeling, others also get it. So empathy is a natural thing. It is a natural force. And it is a social force. In the business sphere, we have market forces, demand and the market. That is the natural thing. People want to exchange. People want to have demand. The corresponding thing, not as a corresponding, but the other natural thing, is empathy. The social entrepreneur's stock differs from business stock. The social entrepreneur's stock is trust. And the social enterprise, the purpose of it is to increase that trust. The more you have increased your trust, the more things you can do. And I call it sort of congealed empathy. It is by regular, constantly doing, having empathy that you develop your social stock of trust. It is a bit like from market forces and financial capital. So in the commercial world, you have actions that based on money. Here you have social action. And the desire in the commercial world is increasing money, ever-increasing profit. The desire in the social world is actually not that. It is social good, and societal balance. The people who are in business and in trade, we have heard this, I think I have also heard here in this classroom, they are very strong on their freedom, the freedom of trade. Free society, free capitalism, freedom. In the social field, the corresponding freedom to that is human rights. So we talk of human rights, and human rights is the base for social entrepreneurship or any kind of social endeavor. So our base is human rights. So we look at the marginalized, their human rights clearly are violated. They may not, if you go along a more liberal interpretation of the UN Charter, human rights are not just political rights, human rights are also social, cultural, economic rights. And definitely having a decent home is one of them. So that is, that corresponds to the freedom that businessmen want for their trade. And empathy is where the social entrepreneur, that is his special tool. Now these are not developed the way the business side is. And that is why I am suggesting that we need a kind of internet where empathy can get built up. In the commercial world, you see the stock in your daily newspaper. And you follow the what is happening in commerce. There is no similar thing for social entrepreneurs today. But we need it, because that's the only way. At the moment, empathy suddenly builds up only for crises, when there is a disaster. But social action is an everyday thing, not just at times of disaster. So the method of having the action-reaction build-up of empathy and the trust as a social stock increasing, we have to develop, and it has to be developed in some fast-acting methodology. The future enterprise actually may be like the old enterprise. That is, has a business and social worlds. But the one thing I remember is that there are no trade-offs between these two. There are trade-offs between dimensions inside the commercial world, between labor and capital, between land and capital. But there are no trade-offs between the social world and the business world. Now, you can't buy human rights. The whole idea of buying rights, emerged in law with sort of neoliberalism in economics, but I don't agree with that. There is no question of buying human rights or buying social action. Companies may want to, but they can't. So this, I think, is the basics from which we operate. To go back to sort of my journey in this, this is myself as a social entrepreneur. This is how I developed empathy. Here I am with the Nubian Kenyans, and here I am with, even with businessmen, we have to build up some empathy with the businessmen who are going to come and work with us. This is the early picture, myself Navy in Varanasi, where we did the silk weavers. We have to talk, understand them, their problems, and build up that empathy into a trust so that we can actually have social action at the end. So you have to do things that I myself was never prepared to do, but here is a child rights march, and I'm taking the only child in that march. We have to end up at the head of the thing. So this is what I think this means. Poverty or the marginalized is usually a way station in life. Lots of people pass through it. The first time I gave a talk in Kenya, the chairman stopped me and asked everyone in the room, have you been in poverty or marginalized situation? Then nobody was saying yes. He said, there's another person in this room who knows that you have been. So he was a religious man. But you see, there is a social poverty is that people living in slums, you may not think of it that way, are living in the highest risk place in town. They're very, very risky. If you have your family in the slums, you're constantly not knowing what is going to happen to your children. There is a tremendous amount of stress. I tell doctors that, if you're a heart specialist, you must help patients from the slums as well as the rich people. Not only chairman of companies, these people have much greater tension. And the emotional poverty, it is the emotional poverty that drives people to alienation and depression. Alienation and depression is a common and massive feature of slums. So the whole process of getting the empathy is by reaching into these areas. So we try to reduce it by empathic action, and bring the people home is really to bring them to a decent status into the mainstream of socio-economic life, a step on the poverty ladder and a step on the financial ladder. The items to be very careful about is that you cannot mix the two spheres. You cannot purchase or trade with money into human rights or into the social dynamic. The other is that there is no stable-state solution, which an economist will evolve to. Social action is dynamic. It is usually a fight. There is no optimum as such. That is not a good term. I can have a first-class housing scheme in a rural area. It starts off very well, but I can tell you what the dynamic is going to be, which is that the people will multiply and this will become a slum unless I have something for the children. In the urban setting, you can have a first-class social housing scheme, but the dynamic of the city is also important. If the city becomes Detroit, what is the purpose of the affordable housing? So bring the people home via the capital market is a methodology. The social REIT, I consider a sort of technical breakthrough in the economic field. The trust is an objective to replant land and replant entire neighborhood. And you might also note that it is not based on any NGO or any state spending. It actually provides a profit to the state, which is usually the landowner, and definitely relieves it of its welfare burdens. Other burdens, such as the use of water illegally, use of electricity illegally, all of these are common in slums. And it is based really on having that regulated market at the marketplace. And there is really no role for the traditional type of donors or NGOs. Not that they are bad, but it's just that this whole process doesn't require them. What it requires is that empathic social entrepreneur, a catalyst and a doer. You must have an objective and you must achieve it at that. So I will now just have this video going. It can be in the background. It shows pictures of the slum dwellers in their normal condition as a slum, and then what happened after they moved to the new building. They had decent housing. Those pictures are taken about 6 years later. Most of these schemes collapse after 2 or 3 years, but in this case, even now, the people are maintaining.